Good morning. Welcome to our Sunday service, Unity of Delaware folks. Joanne here, Buddy, Bella. Joe's behind the camera. He'll join me in a moment. Thank you for taking a little time this morning, just a half an hour or so of a little inspirational message, we hope, a little music, a little prayer together, and of course, a little pet time here. I'm sorry, Valentino, I didn't see you at first. There you go. It's funny, the dogs kind of are here front and center like the first arrivers at church these days. They've got the drill down so well. So thank you so much for joining us. It's a chilly day, but there's a pretty snow coming down right now. And it's a good day to be warm and cozy inside and grateful for our homes. So I'm going to ask Joe to come over, and we'll start with a prayer as we always do. All right, you two. Off with you now, okay? There we go.
On your way.
On your way now. Okay.
Good morning.
Yeah. As always, we want to start with prayer and begin to bring into our minds all those people or situations we're lifting up in prayer. Prayers, of course, for our country, for our communities, for peace, for harmony among people everywhere. Prayers for healing of this virus that's we're still dealing with across the country. Prayers for those who are dealing with it, for healing for them. Prayers of comfort and courage for family members who are taking care of loved ones and caregivers in hospitals across the country. And prayers for all of us and just in dealing with the daily worry, you know, that can be heavy on our hearts sometimes about ourselves, each other, our loved ones, our world. So prayers for all of that. And my Unity of Delaware folks, you might also, who are on a prayer chain, notice a particular prayer went out this morning for a very old friend of ours here in the Unity Columbus area, Doris Reed, 90-something, 94, I think, or so now, and might be leaving us soon, according to relatives. So we are lifting her up in prayer for peace and for a feeling of God's loving presence enfolding her. So whatever is you're lifting up in prayer, please bring that into your mind and heart as we go into prayer with a very simple prayer sung by Karen Drucker called In the Stillness. And if you know it, sing with us. In the stillness of this moment, there is peace, there is peace. In the stillness of this moment, there is peace, there is peace. And I rest and trust. In the stillness of this moment, there is love, there is love. In the stillness of this moment, there is love, there is love. And I rest and trust. Stillness of this moment, there is love, there is love, there is love. As we close our eyes, let's take that truth into prayer, that deep within us, every one of us, in all situations, all circumstances, there is love, there is peace. The power and presence of God is with us all, unfailingly, ceaselessly, unconditionally, and available to us all we need do is remember who we are at a deep level and call it forth. Invite God to flow through us, to fill us with that steadying peace, with that comfort of love, with that deep awareness that we are God-connected beings, and we are equipped with all we need to face the circumstances of each day, moment by moment, by day and by night. We are connected with God at depth, and we are being led in the path of life, of peace, and of unfolding love. This is true for each one of us. This is true for living beings across the globe. We are being guided by God in us every moment toward greater peace and wisdom and abiding love. This is the truth we're affirming this morning, and we are grateful to the power and presence that makes it so. And so it is. All right. Well, taking my topic today is another road, and it's kind of about receiving revelations and making changes and anticipating changes. And for some reason, this old folk song came back to mind strongly. It just seemed appropriate to the day, and it's one you all know, Bob Dylan song. So join us on it wherever you are.
Seems to be always appropriate.
It does seem to. It's one of those songs that transcends time.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man? Yes, and how many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? Yes, and how many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. How many years can a mountain exist before it is washed to the sea? Yes, and how many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free? Yes, and how many times can a man turn his head and pretend that he just doesn't see? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. How many times must a man look up before he can see the sky? Yes, and how many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? Yes, and how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Yeah, good song. Good song. Never gets old. Thank you, Joe. All right. Well, talking about my title is Another Road today. And it seems like this is a time of discoveries, epiphanies, of revelations. Some of them are hard discoveries, and I think there are transformative discoveries going on. And ones that bear paying attention to, right, buddy? Yes. And it seems very appropriate right now. I love the word epiphany. It's of course that it means revelation. It means something like that. But it has this particular meaning in legend and in history. We just passed the Feast of the Epiphany on Jan 6, which according to legend they also call it the 12th night or 12th day of Christmas. According to legend, it was the day when the wise men discovered the Christ child. Following that star, this discovery of this wonderful new potential for human beings in the birth of this child, that happened on the Epiphany. And of course, January 6th is going to be one of those dates we all remember from watching TV or our computer screens last week. And it has this sense of, this epiphany has a sense of emergency about it, urgency, which I think some epiphanies really do. I was interested to learn, you know, as an old English teacher, I love words and what they mean. And the word emergency, any situation that gives us a sense that it's an emergency, the word really means to emerge from, to rise up out of the familiar and into a new atmosphere, and it often demands that we ourselves rise to the occasion. I think that's very much the kind of epiphany that's going on right now, and that old story about the wise men really kind of resonates with me anyway, that, you know, the story goes that the King Herod tried to use the wise men to find the Christ child so that he could kill this child that there was so much prophecy about. But after the wise men discovered the child on the Epiphany, they were warned in a dream to return to their country by another road. Another road. I think this is an important teaching story for us. It's not just something that happened long ago or in a legend from long ago. It's a teaching for a story for us about. We receive epiphanies all the time. I think life is designed that way to help us keep coming up higher and realizing more of our potential, coming into our higher selfhood. And we are meant to step out on those epiphanies when they come to us. We don't have to know the whole course, the whole route home, but we have to take a step on another road, make a choice to step out in a new direction. Doesn't have to be a big step, but it has to be a step. There's a sense of urgency about it. Because an epiphany, it isn't just an intellectual discovery. It isn't that kind of a thing at all. It's something we feel deeply. And I know you've all had an experience like this. They come to us throughout our lives. Some are stronger than others. Some are everyday epiphanies. Some are gut-level epiphanies where we have this sense, I need to make a change. And there's a sense of urgency about it. We need to step out on another road. And it's always that way. After the eureka, after the epiphany or the discovery becomes the new road, something we have to step out on. Even in the midst of our everyday lives and usual activities and obligations, we have to find a way to step out in that new direction, to honor it, or the energy of it is lost. It's dissipated. It's kind of like any of you who are songwriters, if you get a new song idea in mind, don't think, oh, I'll think about that later. You can't. It'll go. There's something about creative energy flowing through us needs to be grabbed, needs to be honored, written down, journaled about, stepped out on in some way, or it'll be lost. It'll die on the vine. So we need to do that, and we need to take note when these epiphanies are coming to us, and they come all the time in all different kinds of ways. And I think this is true sort of on an individual level and also communally. These discoveries are rising in our midst and sometimes spreading among us, but they come to us very often in a very individual way. All of a sudden we discover or we realize something. It could be like you go to a lecture or a class or attend something online these days and you hear words that resonate with you, that inspire you, remind you there's something you need to do or take more seriously or change your beliefs about. Like Unity co-founder Myrtle Fillmore, who went to a lecture long, long, long ago, and heard a spiritual teacher say, you're a child of God, and as a child of God, you do not inherit illness. And as a chronically ill TB patient much of all her life until that point, not expected to live long, those words really rang in her mind, and she took them home with her. I know you Unity folks have heard that story many times. It can happen that way. It can happen through a book, through words you hear from somebody else's mouth, through something you hear online. It can come through the experience of someone else's spiritual presence, someone with a more cultivated spirituality that you hear something or witness something in, and it motivates you. Like a friend of mine locally here who went to, as the age of 18, went to hear a Tibetan Buddhist speaker presentation, and not very long into that presentation at all, she found herself thinking or feeling, again, this is a deeply felt experience, an epiphany, she thought inside, I want what he has. That's a strong epiphany. That's a strong epiphany about how I want to change. And that's something we reflect on deeply for a while and then think about a step to take in that direction. I think this epiphanies are very powerful for anyone who's ever done recovery work, recovering from addictions. There's a point where someone thinks, I can't live like this any longer. And that AA started that way. I was reading again online about the founding of AA, Bill W. and Dr. Bob, and those wonderful stories of how it began. And the very, very beginning of it was Bill W., who had been dealing with his alcoholism for a while, and he was on some kind of a work trip in Akron, Ohio. It was very local stuff for us. It wasn't going well, and he knew he was about to head down that path. He was about to get drunk, and what came to him very clearly in his mind was, I got to find another alcoholic. That's where it began. I just think that's kind of remarkable. And AA has been functioning like that ever since. That was the very beginning. He found Dr. Bob, and they had their first meeting. There's something about helping each other that helps us forward. That's at the core of AA, is find someone else and connect and support one another. That's how we heal. These things come to us all the time, these epiphanies, in so many different ways. And the key thing is that we need to work with the energy of them right away. Don't let it dissipate and drift off, because the choice is always there. Can you just continue with the status quo, what you've always done? That can seem easier. That can seem the most convenient thing. But then you've wasted the energy of that revelation that just came to you. And they're not to be wasted. That's coming from deep within us. And they come to us all the time. The way I see these epiphanies is that an epiphany is a very keen, a sharp experience of divine guidance, of a new truth breaking through, of emergence, something wanting to emerge, and the need to come up into a new consciousness, to take another road. So it's a strong experience of divine guidance. It's not to be squandered. We have to find some way of stepping forward on it. I've been stumbling on more and more lately and feeling myself a new epiphany that's been kind of a communal one for many of us, I think, having to do with social media use right now. I was reading a book recently, a man named Snyder, and he was talking about how we need to become more conscious of and cautious about our use of social media, that it's that it does has so much more effect and impact on others and on ourselves than we realize, because it's so easy to put things out via social media and to share them and post them via social media, and we don't see the damage that might do. And yet we've all experienced it, I think. The distressing, you know, impact of news shared with us via social media, that's frightening. It creates more fear, and it may not be true. Sharing things that we don't know to be true, that could be lies, that incite fear or anger, these kinds of things do inordinate amount of damage that we may not see, and or we may not have any consciousness that we're a part of. And yet, if we use the media without consciousness or caution, we could be doing a lot of damage. And I think a lot of us are becoming much more careful about that. It reminded me of in the early days of email. This is how old I am, but I remember in the very early days of email, it became as a surprise to a lot of us that it's not like a personal letter. You can't just share anything there, gossip about others or things like that, as if you were communicating with one friend, you know, in a personal letter or something. Because email could go anywhere in a moment, could go to somebody's whole address book. And these were rough discoveries. These were hard epiphanies to have way back in that era. I think we are having similar discoveries now when it comes to, as the media we're using have become even more rapid and widespread. It calls us to be even more impeccable with our word and with what we share with one another. Made me think of that wonderful old book, The Four Agreements. I know many of you are familiar with that book. And that was one of those four commitments in order to have a whole, wholesome and a life of integrity is to be impeccable with your word, speak truth, and be careful what you share is truth with others. These are important epiphanies, and we are getting them all the time, moment by moment. And so the key thing is to be conscious of what's coming to us. What discoveries have you been making in this time of discoveries? Some of them hard discoveries, but I think all of them with this potential for transformation to help us realize more of our potential, to come up higher in our consciousness, in our awareness, to become more aware of our connections with one another and how we support each other's healing and wholeness and well-being. What have you been discovering? And then the second question is always, how can you step out on that other road? It doesn't have to be a big step. It can be a decision. I'm going to make this little change. I'm going to start meditating every day. I'm going to start monitoring my social media more carefully. I'm going to be practicing self-care in this new way. I'm going to change the way I relate to others in this particular way. It can be just a start. It could be journal about it. And kind of come up with some ideas as you journal about how you want to enact that revelation that's coming to you. How do you want to step out on it? Because what the way it works is all you have to do is take a step, start walking toward the edge of the light you see, as Mary Manon Morrissey put it. Walk to the edge of the light you see, and then more light will come, and you'll walk to the edge of that. We'll be guided moment by moment, day by day. So let's take that into prayer for a moment. Affirm this high truth and our gratitude for this truth of the living presence of God that is with us moment by moment, the flow of guidance that is available to us, bringing us discoveries, epiphanies, revelations, new and powerful ideas about what's ours to do and how we can come up higher to live a life of greater joy and freedom and integrity and to enable that for one another. We commit ourselves to remember these revelations that come to us and to find ways to step out on them, to set out with trust, with faith, to take a step on that new road, knowing we'll be guided step by step. The power and presence of God is with us moment by moment, and we are grateful, and so it is. Amen. All right, well, we're gonna have another song in a moment, a nice one by about making a change called I'm Willing. And I wanted to make a couple of announcements. Next Sunday, we have a guest speaker. I'm just delighted. I haven't seen him in a number of years, but he did visit the Columbus area out at Unity East years and years ago, Greg Tamblyn. He's a wonderful Unity musician, singer, songwriter, wonderful speaker, motivational speaker, and humorist. He's sort of like a contemporary Mark Twain. And I'm sure many of you in the Unity community are well familiar with Greg Tamblyn. He's such a funny guy. I got a sort of a Christmas present for myself. You know how I love jokes and humor. A little product he puts out called Milk Snort, the joke game. It's something that you can have anybody. It's got lots and lots of jokes, and the idea is to share them at staff meetings or parties or whatever. Anyone can tell a joke. They just pass these around, and everyone is laughing. To give you an idea, here's one of them. It's an old favorite of mine. It's about two senior couples who are visiting at one of their homes, and the men are chatting in one room, the women are out in the other room, and one guy says to the other, oh, my wife and I, we went to this wonderful new restaurant last week. We both fell in love with it. In fact, we've been back twice since then. And the other guy said, oh, what's it called? And the guy thinks for a minute and he goes, well, what's the name of that flower you give women sometimes? It's red, it's got thorns on it. And he said, oh, a rose? He said, yeah. Rose, what's the name of that restaurant we went to last week? I like that one. One of my favorites. Milk Snort. Greg Tamlin is going to be your guest speaker and musician and humorist next Sunday. He's a delight. He can be really funny, and he understands the sacred as well. He's going to be a delightful guest next week.
The Sacred and the Silly.
The Sacred and the Silly, that's his title. So want to thank Joe, as always, for his tremendous help here with all the technology of this, so I don't have to think about any of that. And so he manages to get it out to all of you for your availability whenever. It's always on YouTube, usually by the next day as well. And thank you all for joining us every Sunday like this so that we can stay connected with one another. I so appreciate seeing the comments, where you're joining us from, and you can send in any prayer requests to the community that way as well. And thank you for your generous support of the church heading into this new year. We're still going strong after all this time. We'll still be meeting this way for a little while. So thank you so much for your unfailing support. We so much appreciate that. So we're going to end with a fun song. Why don't you tell them a little bit about who wrote it?
It's a song, we heard Jan Garrett and J.D. Martin do it, but I think it was a co-write between Harold Payne and J.D. Martin.
Uh-huh, yes.
Called I'm Willin'.
I'm Willin'.
Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let me get my egg.
Y'all can sing along. Play your percussion.
There you go.
I'm willing to change my life, willing to shine a little light. I know the change may not come today, but it'll be worth the wait. I'm willing, going out. Change may not come today, but it'll be worth the wait. I'm willing. I've been spending some time alone, way out of my comfort zone. I can't keep on doing the same old thing and expect it to turn out a different way. I'm willing. To shine a little light. I know the change may not come today, but it'll be worth the wait. I'm willing. Yeah, I'm willing. Life is my teacher, time is my friend. I'm gonna follow my heart to the end. Ain't no stop sign on this road. The further I get, the lighter my load. I'm willing to change my life, willing to shine a little light. I know the change may not come today, it'll be worth the wait. I'm willing to change my life, willing to shine a little light. I know the change may not come today, it'll be worth the wait. I'm willing. Yeah, I'm willing. Oh, I'm willing. Yeah, willing.
Yeah.
Yeah, good song by J.D. and Harold.
Good percussion.
Thank you so much. Oh, yeah, not everybody can play the egg.
That's right.
Thank you all for joining us. That just brings us to our prayer for protection. So let's say that together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. So it is. Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday, and stay tuned, and Greg Tamblyn next week will be a treat for all of us, and have a wonderful week. Bless you. Bye for now.